Hello everybody, welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Now before starting with the analysis of today's newspaper, let me highlight as to how we choose the articles for the DNS. Normally we choose the most important articles for the day, and in order to identify such important articles, we normally look at the UPSC syllabus as well as the previous year questions. Now, based upon such an approach, we identify 5 to 6 articles to be analyzed in the DNS. Now, you need to understand that some days there could be around 7 to 8 articles that are important from the UPSC perspective. At the same time, there could hardly be 1 to 2 articles that are worth analyzing in the DNS. Now, if you look at today's newspaper, there are only 2 articles that are worth analyzing in the DNS. The first article is related to the recent killing of the Iran's Major General Qasem Soleimani by USA. And the second article is related to the recent debate about the creation of the All India Judicial Services. Now, apart from these 2 articles, the other articles in today's newspaper are either covered in our previous DNS videos or they are still news in transition, that is, they are still developing stories. Now, for instance, if you look at the front page of today's newspaper, we have an article that is titled as Special Provisions Likely for Jammu and Kashmir Residents in Jobs and Land Rights. As you can read here, this particular article highlights that the government is thinking of a policy to give protection to the residents of J&K. Under this particular policy, only those people who stay in J&K for a minimum period of 15 years would be able to apply for a government job. Now, we are not covering this particular article in today's DNS mainly because of 2 reasons. First and foremost, we have covered the revocation of the special status of J&K in much greater detail in our previous DNS videos. Secondly, you need to realize that this is just a proposal of the government of India, and so far there has been no official confirmation from the government side. So as and when the government comes out with the official policy, we will cover this particular issue in much greater detail. Similarly, if you have a look at today's editorial page, you have 2 articles related to the Citizenship Amendment Act. Now, the Citizenship Amendment Act has been covered multiple times in our DNS videos, and hence in today's DNS, we shall not be covering the Citizenship Amendment Act. The next 2 articles in the editorial page are related to the recent tensions in the West Asia due to the escalation of tensions between Iran and USA. Now, the escalations of tensions in the West Asia would have implications for India. Hence, we would be covering these 2 articles in today's DNS video. Thus, in today's DNS analysis, we shall be covering 2 important articles holistically. The first article is about the recent tensions in West Asia, and the next article is related to the debate about the All India Judicial Services that appears on page number 3. So since there are less number of articles relevant from the UPSC perspective in today's newspaper, I would suggest you to invest your time in revising the news from the previous DNS sessions. The articles to be discussed today has been presented on your screen. Timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. Now the first article appears on page number 3. The title of the article is All India Judicial Service No Panacea, Says the Study. This article shall be important mainly from the perspective of GS Paper 2, Governance, under the subsection Structure, Organization and Functioning of the Judiciary. Recently, the Niti Aayog has published a strategy document known as the Strategy for New India at 75. In this particular strategic document, the Niti Aayog has proposed for the creation of the All India Judicial Services so as to reform the judicial administration in India. However, this particular article highlights that the Vidhi Center for the Legal Policy has opposed the creation of the All India Judicial Services. Now, in the recent times, there has been a growing debate about the creation of the All India Judicial Services. On one hand, the various proponents argue that the creation of such an All India service would lead to the enhancement in the efficiency of the judicial administration. On the other hand, certain actors have opposed the creation of All India Judicial Services since it violates the federal character of the Indian Constitution. Hence, as part of this video analysis, we'll focus on the recent debate about the creation of the All India Judicial Services. But before getting into this particular debate,
let us first understand certain basics that are required in order to understand this particular article. As you all must be aware, the Indian Constitution has adopted a federal structure. In this particular federal structure, there is a distribution of the legislative, executive, and financial powers between the center and states. However, the judicial powers as such have not been distributed between the center and states. So if you look at the nature of the Indian judiciary adopted by the Indian Constitution, we have adopted a single and integrated judiciary. Now, the judiciary in case of India is said to be single because the judicial structure is arranged in pyramidal fashion, with the Supreme Court at the top, followed by the High Court at the state level, and below the High Courts you have the district courts, and below the district courts you have the lower subordinate courts. And secondly, the Indian judiciary is said to be an integrated judiciary because this particular single system of courts enforces both the central as well as state laws. Now, such a structure of judiciary adopted by India is quite distinct from the structure of judiciary adopted in case of USA. In case of USA, the federal laws are enforced by the federal courts, whereas the state laws are enforced by the state courts. So, unlike the other federal countries, in case of India, we have adopted a single and integrated judiciary. However, there are differences in the way the judges are appointed at the different levels of the Indian judiciary. For instance, Article 124 provides for the appointment of the Supreme Court judges, whereas Article 217 provides for the appointment of the High Court judges. On similar lines, Article 233 and Article 234 deal with the appointment of judges at the lower judiciary, right from the district courts to the subordinate courts. Now, with respect to appointment of Supreme Court and High Court judges, these judges are appointed by the President of India based upon the recommendations of the Collegium. However, the judges at the lower judiciary are appointed by the Governor in consultation with the concerned High Court and the state government. And usually, for the appointment of the judges at the lower judiciary, the State Public Service Commission conducts a judicial service examination in the state. And based upon the results of such an examination, the judges are appointed at the lower judiciary in the concerned states. So with respect to appointment of judges in case of India, both the central government as well as the state government play a role, wherein the central government plays a role with respect to appointment of the judges at the Supreme Court and High Court, whereas the state government plays a role with respect to appointment of the judges at the lower judiciary. Now, coming to the idea of the All India Judicial Service. Now, the All India Judicial Service essentially means that a nodal agency such as the UPSC would conduct an All India Judicial Service examination. Now, based upon the results of such an examination, the successful candidates would be allocated to the different states, and these successful candidates would be in turn appointed as judges at the lower judiciary, which means to say that these successful candidates could be appointed as the district judges or the judges at the subordinate courts. So in a way, the All India Judicial Service is similar to the other All India Service, such as the Indian Administrative Service, or for that matter, the Indian Police Service. So once we create a All India Judicial Service, then the state governments would have no role with respect to appointment of judges at the lower judiciary. Now, coming to the constitutional provisions related to the creation of the All India Judicial Service. You need to note that Article 312 of the Indian Constitution deals with the creation of an All India Service by the Rajya Sabha, wherein in order to create an All India Service, the Rajya Sabha is required to pass a resolution which has to be supported by at least 2/3 of the members present and voting. Apart from that, the Indian Parliament has passed the 42nd Amendment Act. Such an Amendment Act has enabled the creation of the All India Judicial Services by the Indian Parliament. Now, to create an All India Judicial Service, we would be required to amend both Article 233 as well as Article 234. In accordance with such a provision, the 42nd Amendment Act has provided that the Indian Parliament can amend both these articles by a simple majority of the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Hence, the 42nd Amendment Act has provided that the amendment of Article 233 and Article 234 shall not be deemed to be a constitutional amendment. Now, you must be aware that a constitutional amendment to the Indian Constitution can be carried out under Article 368 of the Indian Constitution. And if any constitutional amendment is affecting the federal structure of the Indian Constitution, then such an amendment has to be passed by the special majority of the parliament along with the consent of at least half of the state legislatures. However, the 42nd Amendment Act has provided that the amendment to the Article 234 and Article 234 shall not be deemed to be a constitutional amendment under Article 368. Accordingly, two changes have been made here. The first change is that the special majority of the parliament is not needed. Such an amendment can be passed through a simple majority. And secondly, consent of at least half of the state legislatures is not needed under this amendment. Now you need to note that the 42nd Amendment Act is only an enabling feature for the creation of the All India Judicial Services. So the procedure that has to be adopted in order to establish the All India Judicial Service would be, first and foremost, the Rajya Sabha should pass a resolution which has to be supported by 2/3 of the members present and voting in accordance with Article 312. After the passage of such a resolution, then Article 233 and 234 has to be amended by both Lok Sabha as well as Rajya Sabha by a simple majority. And after this, an All India Judicial Service can be established. So having understood the idea behind the All India Judicial Service and the constitutional provisions related to creation of such an All India Service, let us now understand the debate about the creation of All India Judicial Service in case of India. Now the various dimensions that we would be covering as part of this particular debate include, first and foremost, what is the need for the All India Judicial Service, how the creation of All India Judicial Service would benefit, and why the All India Judicial Service is opposed by some of the states. Now with respect to first dimension as to what is the need for the All India Judicial Service, first and foremost, as you all must be aware, presently almost up to 3.5 crore cases are pending across the different courts in India. And as you can see this particular pie chart, out of the total 3.5 crore cases pending, almost up to 88% of the cases are pending in the lower judiciary. Now these cases are pending typically at the district courts as well as the lower subordinate courts. So this huge pendency in the cases at the different levels of the Indian judiciary is in turn undermining the rule of law. Apart from that, according to the Economic Survey 2018-19, most of the lower courts in case of India are presently working below their sanction strength, wherein the Economic Survey has highlighted that presently there is a vacancy of up to 2,579 judges at the lower courts. Hence, by setting up of the All India Judicial Service, we would be able to reduce the pendency in the lower courts and we would also be able to address the huge vacancies that presently exist in the lower courts. So there are a number of benefits associated with the setting up of the All India Judicial Services. Let us understand these benefits one by one. First and foremost, as stated before, in most of the states, the State Public Service Commission conducts examination for the appointment of judges to the lower judiciary. However, it has been found out that in most of these states, the examinations are not conducted on an annual basis, leading to huge vacancies in the lower judiciary. So once the All India Judicial Service is established, the UPSC would be able to conduct examination on an annual basis, and this would in turn lead to the timely recruitment of judges at the lower judiciary. Secondly, presently there are large-scale differences among the states in terms of number of vacancies in the lower judiciary. In some of the states such as Maharashtra, the number of vacancies is quite less. However, in the states such as UP, the vacancies is as high as around 42%. Hence, the creation of the All India Judicial Services would lead to the uniformity in the judicial administration. This is so because once the exam results are announced, the candidates would be allocated to the different states based upon the number of vacancies. Thus, the All India Judicial Service would be able to bring about the uniformity in the judicial administration, and it would be able to ensure that the lower courts across the multiple states in India are able to function at their sanctioned strength. Thirdly, once we start conducting the All India Judicial Service examination, Such an examination would be able to attract the best talent in the country, and hence it would be able to maintain high standards of judicial administration. So in a way, the All India Judicial Services would be able to promote enhanced efficiency of the judicial administration. Nextly, the All India Judicial Services would have a national level outlook, and hence it would be able to promote the national integration. This is so because the candidates may be posted in the states other than their own state. Hence, the judicial officers can function beyond their regional and linguistic interest. Nextly, the creation of All India Judicial Services would also be beneficial to some of the states. This is so because some of the states in case of India are considered to be poor with respect to human resources. And accordingly, these states may not be able to attract the best talent for the recruitment of the judges at the lower judiciary. So the All India Judicial Services would be able to solve this problem by conducting All India exams and appointing the best talent from the other states in such resource poor states. And nextly, once the UPSC starts conducting the examination, it would be required to take into account the reservation that is given for the marginalized section, such as the SCs, STs and OBCs, and accordingly, the creation of the All India Judicial Services would lead to a higher representation of these marginalized sections in the Indian judiciary. Now coming to the third dimension as to why the setting up of the All India Judicial Services has been opposed by some of the states. First and foremost, presently it is the responsibility of the state government to make appointment of the judges to the lower judiciary. And once we set up the All India Judicial Services, then the state governments would have no role in making the appointment of the judges to the lower judiciary. Hence, some of the state governments have argued that the setting up of the All India Judicial Services would go against the principle of federalism. The second reason is the All India Judicial Service officers may not be proficient in the regional languages. Now, if you look at the languages of the courts in case of India, under the Indian Constitution, the proceedings of the Supreme Court and High Court have to be carried out only in English language. However, with respect to proceedings of the lower judiciary, that is the district courts and the lower subordinate courts, under the CRPC, that is the Code of the Criminal Procedure, the state governments have been empowered to choose their own language. So in pursuance of the powers entrusted to state governments under the CRPC, most of the state governments have chosen their own regional language for undertaking the proceedings in the lower judiciary. So accordingly, whenever the judicial officers hear a particular case, most of the arguments and counter-arguments are made in the local regional language. Apart from that, the witnesses also provide their statements in the local regional language. Hence, the judges in the lower judiciary need to be proficient in the local regional language. However, once the All India Judicial Service is established, a person from one state may get appointed to another state, and hence such a person may not be proficient in the local regional language. Thus, even though such a person may be exceptionally talented, but the lack of proficiency of the regional language may act as a handicap. Now, this is precisely the reason some of the states have opposed the creation of the All India Judicial Services. However, this argument put forward by the states may be countered by taking the example of the other All India services. Now, the persons who are appointed as the IAS or IPS, now these persons may be posted in the states other than their home states. However, these persons learn their local regional language and become quite efficient with respect to the administration. Hence, accordingly, it can be argued that if IAS and IPS officers can learn the regional language, the same can be said about the All India Judicial Service officers. So in this regard, it can be stated that the argument put forward by the states looks flawed. The next reason is the higher financial burden on the states. Now, once we start appointing the All India Judicial Service officers, now these All India Service officers would have to be paid higher amount of salaries by the state governments. Hence, the creation of All India Judicial Service would impose a higher financial burden on the state government, and accordingly, some of the state governments have opposed the creation of the All India Judicial Service. Nextly, the creation of All India Judicial Service has also been opposed by the states because it would demoralize the state judicial officers. Now, presently, these state judicial officers are appointed at the lowest level of hierarchy, and these state level judicial officers rise to the hierarchy and they get appointed as the district judges. So presently, there is an opportunity before the state judicial officers to rise through the hierarchy and be appointed as the district judges. However, once we set up the All India Judicial Services, the district judges would be directly appointed based upon the results of an examination. And accordingly, it would reduce the promotional avenues for the state judicial officers, and hence the setting up of the All India Judicial Services would demoralize them. Lastly, some of the state governments have opposed the All India Judicial Services since it would violate the sons of soil. Now, presently, the state governments conduct examination for the appointment of judges to the lower judiciary. And when such examinations are conducted, it provides the employment opportunities to the people within a particular state. However, once the All India Judicial Services is established, then accordingly the employment opportunities to the people within a state would reduce. Hence, some of the states believe that if All India Judicial Services is created, this would lead to decrease in the employment opportunities to the people within a particular state. Now, in case of India, a number of committees have analyzed the benefits as well as problems with respect to setting up of the All India Judicial Services. Some of these committees include the Law Commission, the Shetty Commission on Judicial Reforms. Now, after analyzing both benefits as well as problems, both the Law Commission as well as the Shetty Commission have argued in the favor of the creation of the All India Judicial Services. Apart from that, the Niti Aayog has also favored the creation of the All India Judicial Services so as to improve the judicial administration. Hence, India need to set up the All India Judicial Services, which can in turn reduce the pendency in the lower courts and reduce the huge vacancies which are presently existing in the lower judiciary. Now, these are some of the important aspects which one should know with respect to this particular article. Further, based upon our video analysis, a main question for your practice here could be, even though the creation of All India Judicial Service has been opposed by certain actors, the creation of such an All India Service would be a major step in assuring the judicial reforms and improving the judicial administration. Discuss. Now, in today's newspaper, we have multiple articles related to the killing of Iran's top security and intelligence commander, Major General Qasem Soleimani, by USA. Now, the recent developments in West Asia shall be important mainly from the perspective of GS Paper 2, International Relations, under the subsection, Effect of Policies and Politics of Developed Countries on India's Interest. Yesterday, USA carried out a drone attack in Baghdad, which eventually led to the death of the Major General Qasem Soleimani. Qasem Soleimani was considered to be the architect of Iran's growing influence in West Asia, and hence his killing is said to escalate the tensions in the West Asian region. Already, Iran's supreme leader has vowed to take harsh revenge against USA. Amidst this growing tension, the Indian government has issued an official statement which expresses the grave concerns over the prevailing security situation in West Asia. It has called for both the countries to exercise restraint. Against this particular backdrop, we'll understand as to what led to the recent development, why killing of Soleimani matters, and its implications. Now, in the recent times, there has been growing tensions between Iran and USA on account of multiple reasons, wherein USA has been following the policy of maximum pressure, whereas Iran has been following the policy of maximum resistance. As part of the maximum pressure policy, the US government is trying to force the Iranian government from giving up the nuclear weapons. As part of the maximum pressure policy, the US government unilaterally withdrew from the Iranian nuclear deal and it imposed the economic sanctions. The idea behind the economic sanctions was to prevent Iran from selling its oil to other countries. Subsequently, the US government declared the Iranian Revolutionary Guard as a terrorist organization. In response to the maximum pressure policy adopted by USA, the Iranian government adopted the maximum resistance policy. As part of this particular policy, the Iranian government supported the Yemen-based Houthi rebels to attack the Saudi Arabian oil facilities. It also shot down the US drone and it also attacked the oil tankers in the Persian Gulf. So in the recent times, the tensions between Iran and USA were growing and it ultimately led to the killing of the Major General Qasem Soleimani. Now, as to why the killing of Qasem Soleimani matters, now, Qasem Soleimani was considered to be extremely close to Iran's top leadership. In particular, he was extremely close to Iran's supreme leader. And as stated before, Iran's supreme leader has stated that he would take revenge against the killing of Soleimani. Soleimani also headed the intelligence gathering and military operations of Iran. In particular, Soleimani was in charge of the Kurds force of the Iranian Revolutionary Guard. It is to be noted that the Kurds force under the Iranian Revolutionary Guard carries out the covert operations in the other countries. Further, as you all must be aware, Iran has consistently been accused of staging proxy wars in West Asia, wherein, as part of the proxy wars, Iran has been accused of extending support to certain terrorist-based organizations. For instance, Iran has been accused of extending support to the Lebanon-based Hezbollah organization. It has also been accused of extending support to the Yemen-based Houthi rebels. Now, it is being stated that Qasem Soleimani played a very crucial role in carrying out these proxy wars in various countries such as Syria, Yemen, as well as Iraq. And lastly, Soleimani had a massive public appeal due to his clean and larger-than-life image. Hence, the recent killing of Soleimani has led to the surge in the anti-America sentiment within Iran. Now, because of such strong anti-American sentiment, people in Iran are calling upon the Iranian government to take revenge against the killing of Soleimani. Now, coming to the implications of attack, first and foremost, Iran could retaliate and take revenge against the killing of Soleimani. In such cases, the tensions between Iran and USA would further escalate. Secondly, the growing tensions between Iran and USA would make the Middle Eastern region much more unstable. And with respect to implications on India, now for India, both US as well as Iran are considered to be strategic partners because of multiple reasons. On one hand, India needs the support of Iran for its energy security as well as access to Afghanistan, in particular with respect to development of Chabahar port. On the other hand, we need the support of USA in order to counter China. Hence, the growing tensions between Iran and USA would make it difficult for India to balance its interest. Secondly, the growing instability in Middle East would lead to the increase in the oil prices and hence it would adversely affect India's energy security. Further, the increase in the oil prices would have an adverse impact on our trade deficit, and in future, if the oil prices continue to increase, this can possibly lead to the rupee depreciation as well. Nextly, approximately around 8 million Indians live in the Middle Eastern region. Hence, the growing tensions between Iran and USA would affect their livelihood. And if the tensions escalate further, then the Indian government would be required to carry out a massive evacuation efforts. And lastly, India has a significant Shia population, which is considered to be largest in the world outside Iran. Hence, if the tensions between Iran and USA keep on escalating, then the possibility of some of the youth being radicalized against USA cannot be ruled out. Now, these are some of the important aspects which one should know with respect to this particular article. Now, based upon our video analysis, let us now take up certain prelims-based questions for your practice. Now, coming to the first question here, the first question reads as, which of the following features of the Indian Constitution are said to be federal in nature? Now, in case of India, both the integrated judiciary as well as the All India Services, both these are considered to be the unitary features of the Indian Constitution. However, the supremacy of the Indian Constitution, the independent judiciary, and the 7th schedule that provides for the distribution of powers between the central and the state government, all of these three are considered to be federal features of the Indian Constitution. So, except 3 and 5, all other features are considered to be federal features of the Indian Constitution. So, accordingly, the correct answer to this particular question shall be C. Now, coming to second question, the question reads as, a constitutional amendment related to which of the following subjects requires the consent of the state legislatures? You need to note that an amendment to any provision of the Constitution that is federal in nature requires a concurrence of half of the state legislatures. Accordingly, these are the provisions which would require the consent of at least half of the state legislatures. The provisions here are election of president and its manner, extent of executive power of the union and the states, the Supreme Court and high courts, distribution of legislative powers between the union and states, any of the list in the 7th schedule, representation of the states in the parliament, and the amendment to the Article 368 itself. So if you look at the options here, the first option reads as replacing the collegian system with the National Judicial Appointments Committee. Now this is something to do with the appointment of the Supreme Court and High Court judges, and accordingly it would require the consent of the state legislatures. However, with respect to formation of a new state or the amendments related to citizenship, both these provisions do not require the consent of the state legislatures. So accordingly, the correct answer to this particular question shall be A, that is one only.
With this, we have come to end of today's discussion. Now let us have a look at the question for the day.